The third lecture is going to be given by Professor Hansen. Professor Hansen is a professor of pediatrics and neonatology at the University of Oslo, and he is the director of clinical ethics at Oslo University Hospital. He will talk to us about prevention of severe hyperbilirubinemia.
Thank you so much. So this is our second talk about jaundice today. If somebody will be so kind as to put it up on the screen, and that's me, not worth looking at. But okay. So we're going to talk about how we can prevent severe jaundice. And let's start by asking, what is severe jaundice? Is it a number? And if it is a number, which number is it? In the old days, there was a term called vigintiphobia, the fear of 20 or 20 milligrams per deciliter, because studies back in the 50s and 60s showed that once your bilirubin rose above 20, then the risk of connectors was greater. But there should be at least something about postnatal age in there if we're going to make it a number. And perhaps there needs to be something about gestational age. So severe jaundice is not just about a number. Could it be jaundice that causes symptoms in a neonate? For instance, symptoms associated with jaundice. The term bind has been coined to include drowsiness, anorexia, high-pitched cry, fever, apnea, opisthotonos, as seen in this baby from Ethiopia, and seizures. But we could also argue that severe hyperbilirubinemia is jaundice in an infant who has some risk factors. And they could be risk factors for high TSB levels. For instance, hemolysis, could be family history, could be prematurity, could certainly be said jaundice appearing in the first 24 hours of life, East Asian ethnicity, infants of diabetic mothers, early discharge and inadequate follow-up, all of those are risk factors. Or they could be risk factors having to do with being vulnerable for neurotoxicity. Certainly hemolysis has been argued to be one of those. Low serum albumin means that your binding capacity for bilirubin in serum is lower. Prematurity is a factor. And it's also associated with an albumin that is immature and binds bilirubin less well. Then you are at risk for neurotoxicity if there is something the matter with your blood-brain barrier, which might be the case if you are on the ventilator and your PCO2 is 8 or 9 or 10 kilopascals. If you are hyperosmolar and your urea and your bilirubin, your blood sugar is way up there. And in general terms, if the baby is sick, septic, acidotic. And finally, and this is at this point in time merely a speculation, but we certainly need to consider the possibility that there could be genetic differences in the way that the brain is able to handle bilirubin once it gets in there. So how common is this somewhat poorly defined term? Well, if we define it based on levels of total serum bilirubin, in industrialized countries, the incidence has been described to vary as widely as between 7 and 150 per 100,000 live births. Those are from different industrialized countries. There is also a recent paper by Vinny Butani et al. In pediatric research 4 years ago, where they based this on systematic reviews and meta-analyses and found a global estimate of 360 per 100,000 live births as a global estimate. We could also say that severe jaundice is something that you choose to treat, and that's a circular definition, I admit, but nevertheless, phototherapy, how many babies do we put under the lights? Well, in maternity wards, figures from around the world vary from less than 1% to 8% of all maternity ward babies. We recently completed a 1-year prospective study of the use of treatment of jaundice in all NICUs in all of Norway. So every NICU admitted baby in the whole country for a full year, we have tabs on. And we could show that more than one out of four NICU babies in Norway were actually under phototherapy. And more than 80% of preemie babies less than 28 weeks gestation. There are some survey data from Italy also. More than half of the NICU babies in Italy received phototherapy. Other recorded interventions could be of interest. We are in the process or have just submitted this one-year prospective study, and we found that as far as exchange transfusions or IVIG, we only did one exchange per 10,000 live births, in all other words, six in all of Norway during a full year. Italy, slightly more, 0.2 to 0.4% of all NICU admissions there. Nigeria, that's a completely different world. Just one single NICU in a big Nigerian city did in 120 exchange transfusions. So if your residents need to learn, maybe you should send them there. Now, we could also judge based on the number of reported cases of kernicterus. And there are some national data from a few countries. In Norway, 0.17 per 100,000 live births, which was a case of Crigler-Najjar syndrome. Italy, 0.32, and all the way up to the U.S., which back in the 90s reported 5.3 per 100,000, and into the 2000s had been reduced to 2.9 per 100,000. And these, I'm not going to go into this figure in detail. These are from various parts of the world. And as you can see, the incidence of kernicterus varies widely in different parts of the world. In some areas, it's very high. So what can we do as neonatologists, pediatricians, nurse practitioners to prevent severe hyperbilirubinemia, because that would be the first step in order to prevent kernicterus? So let's ask, can we predict, can we prevent, and can we intervene acutely? And I will try to go through those three different steps with you. So first, prediction. You need to explore family and maternal history. We know that there is an increased risk of severe jaundice if an older sib had jaundice. So ask the mom, has any of your previous children had jaundice? If the answer is yes, that current baby's risk is at least three times that of the background population. If she tells you that I have had two babies who were in phototherapy, well, the likelihood that this baby under your care now will get significantly jaundice is probably at least 10 times that of the background population. So those are not insignificant risk factors. Certainly hemolytic anemias we've talked about. Genetic variants, Gilbert is well known and quite common, at least more common than most of us consider in our daily practice. Crigler-Najjar is unusual except in select ethnic groups. Ethnicity, we've already talked about. High altitude residents, I mentioned in my previous talk, and all these endocrinological risk factors such as maternal diabetes, maternal hypertension, first trimester hemorrhage, etc. All of these are risk factors. Then you need to look at the delivery history. Did the mom get certain drugs? Was delivery in one way or another associated with risk for trauma? As forceps delivery, vacuum delivery, breech delivery, and interestingly also prolonged rupture of membranes. Then you need to look at the infant and assess the infant. Is the infant jaundiced during the first 24 hours? Definitely a risk factor. Is it a boy? Well, we boys aren't quite as bright when it comes to this, and some would say other factors also, but low birth weight, prematurity, delayed meconium passage, breastfeeding, which is a good thing, generally. inadequate nutrition, large weight loss, hematomas and fractures. Several things having to do with a baby that should pique our attention. Then we can measure bilirubin, pre-discharge bilirubin screening. I'm sure many of you have seen this so-called Bhutanian nomogram. Vinny did this particular version of it with serum bilirubin values, and he identified a high risk zone, a high intermediate risk zone, a low intermediate risk zone, and a low risk zone. And Vinny has suggested that your discharge planning of babies could, in at least in part, incorporate the risks that are found by plotting the baby's bilirubin value to its postnatal age in hours. Now this is similar, this is Jeff Maisels, who did pretty much the same thing but using transcutaneous measurements. And once again, he finds the same phenomenon that there are percentile scores which are associated with the risk of developing jaundice that some, in some form or shape required our intervention. Now, how can we screen bilirubin? Well, we can do serum bilirubin. There are different methods. Diazo methods, you have to send them off to the lab, probably depending on how quick your lab is, take at least an hour. There's co-oximetry on your blood gas machines. That's a quick one, takes 2 minutes. There's HPLC, which some would say is the gold standard. That takes forever. There are challenges in all analyses of the serum bilirubin. There's precision, there's the time requirements, equipment needs and maintenance, reagent needs and supply and cost. So it's not a quick and easy solution. You can estimate bilirubin by visual inspection. We've talked about that already. It's very dependent on your light source, the wavelength distribution of your ambient light, the experience of the observer, and it unfortunately distinguishes very poorly between moderate and relatively high levels in the first day to day and a half of life. So it's not very useful in connection with early discharge. You can somewhat improve your precision if you use a comparison source like shown in the picture, which is known as the Gossett or Ingram icterometer. Transcutaneous measurements are devices that when you put them in contact with the skin and you push the button, it sends a flash of light into the skin and it measures the reflected light, and then this machine has very ingenious algorithms on a computer chip that calculate what your TSB might be. There are different manufacturers. They're not inexpensive. They need to be serviced. Some of them need disposable supplies, and their precision at extreme levels of TSB is just so-so. But they're very good screening devices. And recently now in the pipeline, there are smartphone apps. There's one called Billycam, and there's one called Picturus, where you take a picture of the baby's forehead or chest, and it compares with an integrated, either an integrated color scale or one that you have to hold next to the baby. And now in the pipeline also is something called Billystick from a recently formed company called Billymetrics in Trieste in Italy. It uses a 25 microliter blood sample, has a reaction time of less than 2 minutes. It's portable, battery-powered, has very good correlation with TSB, and is approaching market. And I spoke recently with Claudio Tirabelli, who is one of the founders of this company, and he told me to tell you that if you're interested in doing a trial of this device, he'd welcome your contact. Discharge and follow-up routines, how important are they? Well, early discharge is certainly a novelty as far as the transitioning process that all newborn babies go through. Now, we know about respiratory and circulatory transition. I'm sure you teach all your medical students about these things, right? And they're done in seconds, minutes, or hours. sometimes days. Bilirubin transitioning takes much longer. In fact, in early discharge, bilirubin transitioning is not nearly completed when you send the baby home. In fact, if the baby is breastfed, it takes weeks before that transition and process is completed. Now, so when you plan for discharge, you need to consider risk factors. How many risk factors, which risk factors, how relatively important are they? Then the parents come into play. Parents come in all sizes and shapes and at all levels of incompetence, from your mother who has had five babies previously to the first time mom. So how knowledgeable is she? How able to cope is she? And the other important question that I'll get back to shortly is, who will be responsible for follow-up after discharge? Is it the birth hospital, the private doc? Is it a health center or a well baby clinic? How available are these if you plan to have the baby followed up outside the hospital? Are they available around the clock? How far does the mom have to travel? Is it easy to get transport? Is transport expensive beyond her means, perhaps? And what kind of diagnostic resources do they have at the place of follow-up? Do they have any therapeutic resources like phototherapy? And what kind of transfer agreements are in place? So I'd like to comment on the Norwegian experience. We have had one case of connectors in 10 years and 600,000 newborns. And it happened because people at the local maternity did not follow the national guidelines. Had they followed the national guidelines, this would never have happened. And our guidelines are extremely simple. Responsibility for follow-up of infants with neonatal jaundice during the first 2 weeks of life is the sole responsibility of the maternity or NICU from which the infant was discharged after birth. Not the family doc, not the health center, not the well baby clinic, and not the emergency service. Parents are given a pamphlet about neonatal jaundice, and on it is written the phone number that they should call if they have questions about suspected jaundice in the baby. The staff in the NICU or in the maternity are told that if a mom or dad call about suspected jaundice in the infant, there is actually only one permitted answer. And that answer is not, as I've heard, put the baby in the window, put the baby out in the sun. There's only one permitted answer, and that is, please bring the baby here right away so that we can examine her or him. And this is what failed in the single case of connectors that we have seen. So when such parents then go to the hospital, they go straight to the maternity or the NICU. There is no involvement of the emergency room or the admissions office or department. Baby is immediately checked with TCB or TSB on a blood gas machine. And if the baby is seen to be extremely jaundiced and or is symptomatic and could be ascribed to early connectors, then the baby is immediately put under high-intensity phototherapy without waiting for test results. So this is what the guidelines look like, but I'm showing it to you to suggest to you that the reason why we have been successful is not because of how this chart looks. This chart is no more nor any less evidence-based than any other bilirubin chart in the world. But bilirubin guidelines are not about TSB members for when to start and stop, or at least they're not only about those. Bilirubin guidelines, I say, must be a total package. It must be risk assessment incorporated into management plans. You must factor in inadequate parental coping skills. You must map and analyze your system, tweak and change it as needed, remove stumbling blocks. Now, Vinnie Bhutani, who is a guru, has coined this term, the crash cart approach. And this is a crash cart. I'm sure you have one in your hospital. It's a trolley or a cart on wheels with all kinds of emergency equipment on it. You can roll it along and it's ready to go. So when you have systems in place and tested, you have designated who's responsible, you have found out what are the bottlenecks in our hospital, and you have removed them. You have trained, you have practiced, and you have the tools available, or to use a phrase, you are ready and raring to go. You must treat every case of extreme jaundice as a medical emergency. Infants should not be kept in a waiting room. They must be fast-tracked to a NICU. You do not need to wait for any test result. If the baby is severely jaundiced, phototherapy never killed anyone. So get intensive phototherapy started immediately. So this is an example for some years back when I was working at Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh. We had four babies admitted with extreme jaundice. In three out of four patients, we were able to reduce the bilirubin by 170 micromoles in 2 hours by phototherapy alone. In other words, by the time that blood for an exchange could have been available, those bilirubin levels were much less dangerous than they were on admission. With some European colleagues, I was able to assemble six cases of babies who had had intermediate to advanced acute bilirubin encephalopathy. Two of the six had MRIs that show basal ganglia changes. All were treated emergently and aggressively, and none of them have full connectors type C coulee. And here's another example of a baby who had opisthotonus, retrocollis, MRI changes, and who was described as normal. She had both IVIG, phototherapy, and an exchange transfusion. The U.S. Connectors Registry contains more than 100 patients who have been reported voluntarily. 11 patients were on retrospective review found to have been treated with a crash cart approach. 8 of those 11 have no overt sequelae. 12 patients were identified who had not been treated aggressively. All of them have sequelae compatible with the diagnosis of connectors. So what is it that works? Well, rapid reduction of total serum bilirubin. We are thinking photoisomerization alone could have an effect. I've talked about that in the other lecture. So key steps in prevention: risk screening before discharge, education of parents, time follow-up according to individual evaluation. Our practice in Norway is follow-up by birth hospital only during the first 2 weeks of life. Key steps in the crash cart approach: remove obstacles. No need to wait for lab results. Phototherapy first, ask later. No interruption in phototherapy until serum bilirubin is well below exchange limits. And make sure that phototherapy is maximally efficient. Remember spectral power. Spectral power is the key phrase or concept in phototherapy. Irradiance is fine. It doesn't help anything if you shine light on a stamp site skin area. So spectral power is irradiance multiplied by the size of the skin area that you irradiate. So both are needed. Blood work and get ready to do an exchange. Liberal enteral feeding could reduce intrahepatic circulation. If there's any history of ABO or IV or rhesus incompatibility, I would give IVIG. Perform exchange in any baby who is extremely jaundiced and has neurological symptoms of acute bilirubin encephalopathy. Always treat emergently and aggressively, even if you have signs of bilirubin encephalopathy. There is no reason to concede defeat. So, summing up, connectors is very rare in industrialized countries. It's less rare in low and middle income countries, but it's still easy to forget that it exists. It will never become extinct in the sense that you no longer need to worry about it because the risk factors will continue to be with us. So thanks.
Thank you very much, Prof. Hansen, for excellent presentation.